Whether you live in Oakland County or not, you are paying this guy. District court judges' salaries are made up of county tax money and state tax money. Once you see what I catch this judge doing, I think you'll have a major objection. It's Monday morning, May 20th at the 52nd District Court. The docket is full. Court starts at 8:34 sharp. All these defendants and all these attorneys are waiting, but His Honor isn't here. By 9, there's still no judge in this Novi courtroom. In fact, the judge isn't even in Novi. There's his shiny white vehicle in front of his house miles away.
It's 9:08, and he has not left for work yet.
All rise for the Honorable Dennis Powers.
My opinion right now is that you're kind of a lazy judge.
Well, that's your opinion.
A guy who's sucking in a salary of $138,272 a year of taxpayer money.
You're never at court on time, are you?
I'm where I'm supposed to be, when I'm supposed to be, whenever I'm supposed to be there.
And having one heck of a good time doing it.
Judges are supposed to be in court and take care of business, and they do that.
And we you take care of business.
I take care of business.
Today I don't feel like doing anything. It's 9 a.m. on Friday, May 17th. The courthouse is open. There's the judge's wheels parked in front of his house.
It is 9:05, and there's the judge's car.
Judge Powers doesn't even leave his home until 11:55. He's already 3.5 hours late. 12:15, and here he is chowing down and chewing the fat in a Waterford gas station / Subway / Dunkin' Donuts. 12:55, the judge heads into McDonald's. Quite an appetite for a guy who hasn't been to work yet. 1:05, Judge Powers goes to the credit union in Waterford. Gotta take care of all that taxpayer money he earns. At 1:27, the judge is in Union Lake, filling his tank. And at 2:20, Judge Powers arrives for a long, hard day at court. But not too long, since the courthouse closes in 2 hours and 10 minutes. And if you think this was an easy day, wait until I show you what he does on Monday. But first, I gotta show you the courtroom calendar. There are 3 judges at Novi's 52-1 court. Judges Bondi, Powers, and McKenzie. While it appears Judge Bondi has this week off in March, Judge Powers is listed as attending a conference. But I found out Judge Powers wasn't at a conference. He was in Aruba.
Yes, yo!
Relaxing at the La Cabana Beach and Racquet Club. The judge belongs to a vacation plan called Blue Green Resorts. He was booked at the Solera Surfside in Miami in January, the same week his calendar says he was at another conference. February, he was booked at the Casa del Mar Resort, the exact same week his calendar says he was at another conference. And in late April and early May, we actually follow the judge during his conference week.
In my Tennessee mountain home.
There he is, vacationing with his wife at the Mountain Loft Resort in Tennessee. Yep, it's another conference week. And there's Judge Powers at another blue-green resort, living it up. After taking a whole week off work, the judge has the nerve to show up 1 hour and 45 minutes late when he gets back on the job. But that's no surprise, because I watched him pull into the parking lot late all the time. Remember, court starts at 8:34 a.m.
Always late.
Always late, yes, it's always the same. Procrastination is my middle name.
And even though he always showed up late, he's always up for a nice break from the courthouse here at the Donut House. The clock is ticking, but the judge is kicking. Kicking back with a long john and a lady friend. Judge Powers isn't a hanging judge, he's a hanging around judge. We watch the judge loaf around for days and days and days, but nothing like this next day. Monday, May 13th, it's 11:03 and the judge hasn't even left his house yet. His docket had 23 cases, all starting early in the morning. 11:32, the judge gets a car wash just a mile from the court. 11:36, fill her up. Gee, the judge hasn't even been to work yet, and he's not going. 12 noon. Judge Powers is at a swanky country club in Commerce Township, First, he gets his grub on, and then he gets his game on. Why waste a nice day in a stuffy old courthouse? Instead of swinging the gavel, Judge Powers spends his whole day swinging his golf clubs. Exactly 1 week after the golf day on May 20th, I'm ready to bring some order to the court.
Hey, where were you this morning?
Where were you this morning?
Well, you had court at 8:30 and I had a camera in the courtroom request and you didn't show up till close to 10 o'clock.
Well, I didn't show in the courtroom until 10 o'clock, that's correct, sir.
I saw you pulling into the parking lot at around 9:57.
Well, I don't know what time it was for sure, but it could have been, yes, sir.
Okay, where were you? How come you were late?
I had to run an errand.
He didn't run any errand. He didn't leave his house until 9:30.
What time did you get to work on Friday?
Noon, I think.
No, you got to work at 2:20. What did you have going on Friday that made it so you didn't get to work till after 2 o'clock?
I had a meeting.
You had a meeting?
Yes, sir.
Who was the meeting with?
I'd prefer not to say.
Well, I'd prefer to say. Here's his meeting.
What happened last Monday when you canceled your whole docket?
We had a golf outing.
Had a golf outing?
Yes, sir.
So you canceled your whole docket?
Yes, sir.
So you had a whole bunch of attorneys and defendants and...
I canceled it ahead of time. Mm-hmm. It was a chamber golf outing. Mm-hmm. That's correct. I participated in that. Yes, sir.
But aren't you being paid by the county to be a judge?
Yes, sir.
Do you think you put in a good week of work last week?
I do, sir.
Oh, yeah. This poor guy worked like a dog.
Wouldn't it be an inconvenience for the attorney to have to reschedule everything because the judge is off golfing?
But you know, you put off golfing is a little bit different than being in a community golf outing. And you'll find out that that's part of what being a judge is about.
Gee, I thought this was what being a judge was about. And what about all those weeks of conferences that are on the judge's calendar?
Where were you?
I was on vacation.
You were on vacation. Well, why does it say conference then?
It's just the way it was worded on the docket.
Gee, that's funny. You're the only judge who has his vacation days listed as conference. So how many actual vacation days has the judge taken this year?
This year, I think I've taken eight, nine, ten, something like that.
So you're going back to court now?
No, I'm going to go golfing right now. I got my clubs and I'm heading off for the golf course.
Are you being sarcastic? I don't even know.
I'm being sarcastic.
Okay,
yes,
well, you were golfing last week, weren't you?
I was golfing
last week. And you had
Monday.
A docket.
I had no docket. I canceled the docket to attend a chamber golf outing.
Well, I'm going to go get the docket so I can see, and I'll talk to those attorneys, and I'll see how they felt, and the defendants, how they felt about the fact that you canceled the docket and they took days off from work and they rescheduled things and you were out golfing, and I'll see what they have to say.
I couldn't find out what those defendants and attorneys had to say because the court would only release this piece of paper. It states that 23 cases had to be rescheduled the day Judge Powers decided to go golfing. There are no names, no case numbers. I also asked the county in court for the judge's official vacation records. Once again, no go. With that, I rest my case. A couple of months ago, I met with 12 members of various families that were really hurting. Each of them cried. Each told me how they missed their children, their brother, their sister. They say it all happened after a chance meeting with a charismatic chiropractor. A few agreed to express their love and their pain on camera.
When I look at my daughter's picture, it hurts.
I'm afraid of losing her forever.
They are the parents, hurt and heartbroken.
I would like her to come home and have a life of freedom.
They say their own children have been turned against them.
She called me and said that she was going to cut all ties with the family.
Turned against their brothers and sisters.
I feel like she's been brainwashed.
Have they been saved?
I have no problem with her having a walk with Christ. It's just that she has no free will.
One thing is certain. They've been changed. It's just before 10 a.m. at Agape Massage Therapy in Clinton Township. The workers arrive in back, packed into cars. You might think they were carpooling. That is, if you didn't know, many of these people live together in communal houses. They live together, play together, pray together. Who are these young people? According to these parents, some are kids who've been lured away from them, away from their futures.
My big concern came when all of a sudden, my daughter dropped out of Wayne State University.
You may recognize Rich Fisher. He was one of Detroit's most popular television anchors for years. He spent the last few years trying to get his youngest daughter back from what he calls a cult. Tom has a daughter in the group as well.
She gave up a $20,000 scholarship.
Tom's other daughter, Allison, says her sister, Sydney, met this group's charismatic leader, Craig, and left everything behind.
Within a weekend, she decided to drop out of school, you know, and basically not communicate with myself or my father or any of her friends.
George says his daughter, Jessie, was actually sent here on an internship from Wayne State, where she was studying kinesiology.
Evidently, she encounters Craig at the chiropractic office, and he cast a demon out of her.
Kavette is Jesse's mom.
And I said, well, Jesse, we need to talk about this. You can't just walk away from your whole life. And she's crying more and more, and the phone went dead. And we did not hear from her again for over a month.
The family found Jesse living in a communal house, working at Agape. I sent a pair of Fox 2 producers into Agape Massage Therapy and Chiropractic. They were led into the back by this 19-year-old massage therapist, Natasha. While one female producer got an hour-long Swedish massage, the other producer chatted up Natasha in the dimly lit room. Christian music played in the background.
Is this what you always wanted to do? I always wanted to be a lawyer. Or, like, I'm totally different. Yeah, I was going to law school and stuff.
Like, how'd you fall into this?
You know, sometimes it's like, you just know the path you're supposed to go. Sometimes you just know where you're supposed to be.
While Natasha's parents aren't in the group I spoke with, her story of leaving school to work giving cheap massages seems the same. The cost of this massage, $17.50. And like the girls whose parents I did speak to, Natasha seems to be in an almost trance-like state of religious fervor, spending time between her massages out back, singing songs to Jesus, and praising.
A lot of praying, a lot of speaking in tongues.
She's giving like most of the other people, massages, because that apparently is what he teaches.
He is Dr. Craig Stasio, their boss and spiritual leader. The parents say their kids call him the prophet.
I think that they're living the gospel according to Stasio, and whatever he says goes.
He wants to have them, his cult members, completely under his control.
Several sources tell me Craig Stasio's message is one of an upcoming doomsday. Here's some literature, the tribulation. It will last for 3 years. People will be in terror and fear. The sign of the beast is a computer chip. In order to get food and water, you must denounce Jesus. Most people that are churched will hold on to the law and perish in the fire. Scary stuff. And some of these kids totally buy it and can't believe their parents don't.
She would come home and tell me that I will march in Satan's army.
But here's what's really scary. According to the state of Michigan Department of Community Health, in 2008, the state found Stasio in violation for negligence. Among the strange violations cited is one very alarming for someone who surrounds himself with young women. Initials are used for one of his massage therapists. It says, Stasio asked WW to give him a massage so that he could critique her technique. Respondent Stasio has admitted once he and WW were in the massage room together, respondent engaged in a sexually explicit conversation and sexual activity with WW that resulted in respondent ejaculating on the floor.
he's manipulative. He knows how to talk to people and control people.
But Craig Stasio sure didn't have much to say when I tried to talk to him.
I want to talk to you about all the girls you have working inside your place.
You can feel free to talk to my attorney.
No, I don't want to talk to your attorney. I want to talk to you.
After you talk to your attorney, if he wants me to talk to you, I'll be glad to.
Do you consider yourself to be a mentor to all these young people?
Like I said, if you'd like to talk to my attorney, you can.
Now I show Stasio the state paperwork where he admits to having a sexual encounter with one of his therapists.
Tell me about this thing right here.
You have yourself a wonderful day.
Are you a cult leader? Do you lead a cult of people?
Like I said, you can talk to my attorney.
And when I went into Agape Massage and tried to talk to the employees there, well, their reaction seemed unusual.
What's your name?
My name's Leah.
Leah?
Mm-hmm.
Leah, can I ask you, you know, I've talked to some of the parents of some of the girls at work here.
No comment. Thank you.
Trouble. Lord, trouble set me free. I have seen your face and it's too much for me.
There's no real emotion from her.
Trouble, oh, trouble, can't you see? You're eating my heart away and there's nothing much left of me.
You're just not the same person.
I want my daughter back.
You, so won't you be kind to me?
This is Chrysler's Jefferson North Assembly Plant. More than 3 million square feet of factory. 2,833 well-paid union auto workers pass through these gates. Inside, they build one of the crown jewels of the Chrysler line, the 2011 Jeep Grand Cherokee. Less than 2 months ago, President Barack Obama himself stood on the floor of the Jefferson North plant and spoke to a cheering crowd of workers. Who wouldn't applaud the man who signed off on more than $6 billion of government money to save their jobs?
And I want all of you to know I will bet on the American worker any day of the week.
Yep, this place is still here because of our tax money, a giant bailout. Man, you'd think if the President of the United States stopped by your work to give you a pep talk, you'd be inspired to do more, to be more, to build more, to drink more.
B-double-E-double-R-U-N, beer run. B-double-E-double-R-U-N, beer run.
We got a tip that some Chrysler workers were using their lunch break to catch a buzz. So we started following them just 5 days after President Obama's visit and caught them day after day hitting up the party store, then hitting the public park to pound beers. Oh, and did I mention a little smoking?
The day shift at Jefferson North starts at 6 a.m. At 11, there's a half-hour lunch break. The partiers have just enough time to head up to the liquor store, drive about a mile to the park, consume for 10 minutes, and get back to the plant in time to work the last 3 hours of their shifts.
Tuesday, September 14th, 10:57 a.m. Here comes our crew out for break. Now at the party store, 11:07. Hitting the coolers for some liquid refreshment. These guys are team players. Check out this handoff. He takes that quart of beer and adds a king can as he waits in the checkout line. This guy's got his hands full too. Looks like he was buying one for his buddy in the minivan. It's 11:09 and the party's starting. These dudes join the bash at 11:11. A minute later, here comes the Big Brew crew. These guys never missed a day we were watching.
And if your dreams are down,
last but not least, these guys show up at 11:15. They brought their A game. This dude takes a hit, takes a swig, another drag, then slugs on a mini bottle.
Taking care of business every day. Taking care of business every way.
The party breaks up at 11:22, and by 11:25, everybody's back at the factory, on time. Wouldn't want to be written up for being late. And remember, we saw this day after day after day. In fact, every day we went to the park during lunch, people were there partying. Finally, last Friday, we'd seen enough.
Hey guys, hate to be a buzzkill, but shouldn't you guys be building cars? Don't you guys work out at the Chrysler factory? You know, the government spent a lot of money bailing you guys out, and you coming out here on your lunch break drinking like this? Where are you guys going, man? You gonna go build some cars now after you had a few beers?
Is a big shot who owns a house on the lake.
How about doing yourself a favor and getting off my property?
Ed likes to chase away people who aren't big shots and don't own a house on the lake.
You know, backlot owners are not allowed to go to a lake. That kind of attitude, you know?
The problem is, the place Ed is chasing people away from isn't his property. It's the lake's public access property next door. Ed is a big fish in a little pond.
Well, I've been on council since 1984. Yeah, I'm an up-and-up guy.
And it just so happens, I'm going fishing. Welcome to Wolverine Lake, a village tucked right between Novi and Milford. Lots of people have lakefront homes. Others in the community can access the lake from areas called public road ends. All the road ends look like this, inviting, with soft, sandy shores. All of them, except this one, the one located next to Councilman Ed Sinkowitz's lakefront home.
He'll go down and tell him it's private property, it's not public access. He's told people to leave.
Cassie lives a few houses down from the lake. She says Ed has been keeping her and her neighbors out of the water using intimidation and dirty tricks. His latest, a barrier of cattails.
This has gone on for years, and he'll create another obstacle after another to make sure people don't go down there.
I don't trust him to begin with.
Pete's been feuding with Ed Sinkowitz for 30 years. He says Ed's parked his work trucks to block him off the lake, planted trees, placed rocks in the water. Although Ed's antics have raised some eyebrows with the council, Mr. Councilman always seems to come out on top.
I don't talk to him.
You don't talk to
him? I have no interest on a man at all.
So what would happen if somebody came up with a rowboat? Would he get all mad?
I think yes, he probably would.
Well, let's find out. I sent two 16-year-old boys out to the lake access point next to Ed Sinkowitz's home. The kids try to launch a kayak through the dense reeds and rocks on the shore. It's sure not easy, but they eventually make it. By the time they get back, Ed's waiting.
That's not your property.
Along the side, that's not our property.
That where you're sitting is not your property either.
This is public access.
Pardon me?
This is public access.
No, it's a road easement.
Ed tells the kids he's not going to report them, but they've damaged the cattail barrier.
Sorry about that.
No, it's just that there's a reason that's there, that was actually planted there.
Ed has succeeded once again in scaring off his neighbors. No one goes down to the lake for weeks until me, my producer and cameraman, decide to do a little fishing.
Unfortunately, this is a road easement and they don't allow fishing down here.
They are out fishing on public.
No, it's a road easement. It's not a public. It's not a outlot. It's not a subdivision outlot. You're taking a chance walking out there and stuff.
No.
There's a lot of stones in there because they put that in there. So when the water comes down here, it kind of gets.
Yeah. So this isn't a public road end.
It is a road easement.
I just sit and listen, wearing my fishing disguise, as Ed fills my producer in on the cattails barrier.
This was put in here intentionally to kind of keep the crap from coming in.
I wonder what he means by crap. Us? His neighbors?
Didn't they pass a law a couple of years ago about opening up the public road?
The law is, trust me, because I'm part of the village over here.
Ooh, that's right, Mr. Big Time Councilman. But he won't report us if we go away.
I'm not going to make a complaint. I'm not going to make a stink. All I want to do is tell you, like I told the last guys that came down and took a boat and ran it right through all that, knocked down all that growth there that they've been trying to put up.
Who put the growth up?
The village did.
Village did.
DNR.
Well, Well, that's news to me. And speaking of news, time for us to bring out our news camera.
I'm Rob from Fox 2. You show me on this law here where it says we can't fish here.
That's right. I got the law in my hand, and I think on my side.
Did you plant all these reeds here?
Nope.
You didn't? Who did?
Mother Nature.
Mother Nature did?
Gosh, Ed, you just admitted a few minutes ago they were planted there.
You didn't plant all those? Because the neighbor said you planted all that. Mm-mm. Well, then can I go knock them down?
I don't think you should.
Why?
Are they yours?
Are they yours?
Ed's going to try to talk his way out of this.
The whole idea of that was a buffer because...
Wait a minute. I thought Mother Nature grew it there.
At one time...
You'd think as an elected official, Ed would hold himself to higher standards.
Aren't you the, the township council guy?
I'm one of the council members, yes.
Yeah. Well, so you're trying to chase us off this property, and it's not your property, is it?
It's a road easement.
Mm-hmm.
And if you did your homework, you would have found out that it went through the legislature about what can be done and what can't be done with road easements.
And what can be done. Doesn't say anything here about fishing. Look, here's my fishing light.
Good. This first just one you ever bought?
Probably is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you don't really give a damn one way or another, do you?
Oh, I do give a damn. I give a damn about somebody who's using their power to bully a bunch of neighbors. The neighbors here care about this area. They want to take advantage of the lake. I live in this area. I might want to take advantage of the lake. Okay. I pay my taxes. It's a public lake.
Yep.
Ed goes back inside, but can't resist coming back out.
How about doing yourself a favor and getting off my property?
Then he calls the cops on us.
All I was trying to explain to them is what...
Really, you called the cops, Ed?
...could be done down here.
This poor officer has to sit here and listen to this.
Well,
We're on public property.
You're telling me you're going to rip out the bushes and everything. I don't know what you're up to. You're a loose cannon, man.
Oh, yeah, I'm crazy. Hi, officer. How are you?
Okay, there's one truth.
Here's another truth for you, Ed. You're in the Hall of Shame.